Hello, how is everybody? Good. We got a great AV crew, and we haven't thanked them for the past 2 days, so let's everybody give these guys a hand. They're very particular about the mic placement, which is great, so we actually sound good, and that's something that I appreciate. How's the show going for everybody? Good? Everybody energetic? Didn't stay out too late? Go too crazy? Yeah, I see. Maybe. All right. I was good last night. Maybe the next couple of nights, I don't know, but so far so good. I'd like to know the kind of mix of people that we have in the audience before we introduce ourselves. Do we have integrators? Okay, distributors, manufacturers, and all the above. Anything else that you don't qualify? So what are people that I didn't mention? Residential properties. Okay, that's cool. Oh, that's perfect. All right. If you have a question, please use the microphones. And the reason why I'm saying that is A, we can hear you, but B, we can get it captured because we're recording audio and video. I don't know if I told you guys that, but you're being recorded for posterity. All right. So welcome to the Smart Homes for Sustainable and Independent Living panel. I'm Walt Zerbe. I'm Senior Director of Technology and Standards for CEDIA, and I also host the CEDIA podcast, and I want you guys to give some background when you do your introductions as well. I've been in the industry for about 30 years, or over 30 years, both from having an integration company to being a product manager for 20-something years to being very involved in writing standards and recommended practices with the Consumer Technology Association and CEDIA for how to install technology in a residence properly, whatever that is. So that's a little bit about me. And let's move to you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Paul Doyle. My title is Assistive Technology Consultant. My main role is that of a clinical technologist. I've been working with people with physical, sensory, and cognitive disabilities for about 25 years, supporting their independent living with technology. More recently, I've been working within the field of medical legal. So we're looking at employing and adapting assistive technology, smart home technologies, to enable people to live more comfortable and enriched lives.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Alan?
Good morning, everybody. My name is Alan Burns. I'm a science teacher who became a renewables energy installer, who became a smart home installer. I'm focused on sustainability in smart homes. I like twinkly lights and nice sounds, but my focus is energy. In my career as an installer, I have had to implement smart home solutions. For a person with dementia, it was a very interesting experience, which tuned me to look for more guidance and solutions. I've chatted with Paul a few times in the past, trying to learn more about how smart homes can be adapted to support people who need independence. And I'm just happy to keep the conversation going.
Okay. I did not know you were a science teacher. That's cool. Like what level of what types of, you know, level of grade did you teach?
Secondary, 11 to 18, so like your sort of right high school through to senior high or baccalaureate level.
Right.
6 years science teaching, mainly physics, hence my interest in energy.
Okay, very good. So one interesting thing just right off the bat with this subject, a lot of the things on the show floor are nice to haves. You know, we've got cinema, we've got multi-room audio, we've got great video, but this topic applies to absolutely every human on the planet. Both the sustainability talk as being proper stewards of the planet and doing our best to manage our usage, especially energy, and then we're all going to get older. Well, we obviously are getting older, but we're all going to need help as we get older. It's not, in the United States at least, you used to prepare yourself to live in a facility that was incredibly expensive, and it is not, that is not going to be obtainable for the newer generations because they can't afford it. A, there's that, and B, we don't have the space. So that means that we're going to need technology to help us live and stay and continue, hopefully, to live where we live now. So this is a major opportunity because it applies to everyone. So the first question I'm going to ask is, we've been talking about this for a long time, right? And sustainability has definitely got more of a leg hold now because we have some things that we can do as far as sustainability goes. But as far as assisted and independent living, not so much. So why are we still trying to get this over the hump? Who would like to start? And we can take this wherever we need to go.
One of the questions I would, well, not one of the questions, but the thing I would do is reflect it back out to the audience.
Oh yeah, great.
Yeah, because I've been working with, as I say, with assistive technology for nearly 30 years now. And I'm aware that people are aware that technology can have play an integral part in keeping people with physical disabilities in control of their immediate environment. So being able to turn the lights on or open and close the windows and doors, these are things that for people with mobility impairments are really important. And we're not actually telling anybody anything new, but when it comes to actually implementing it, people start to get a little bit hesitant. Now, whether that's through risk, and I'll be perfectly frank, many people who are working with people with disabilities find the concept quite challenging because they've never worked with somebody who speaks in a specific manner or has communication that's either non-verbal or they scream or shout because that's their only way of talking. So there's an embarrassment or an uncomfortableness that's associated with that, which working with the disabled community for 30 years, I no longer feel that, but I can understand that there's a Rubicon that needs to be crossed.
Yeah, so did you have a specific question that you would like to get a response from the audience?
Yeah, presumably people who are here today are thinking along the lines of this is something of interest to me. Why haven't you started implementing this technology now?
Okay, let's do a show of hands first. Who's interested in sustainability the most? And who's interested in the assisted living side the most? Okay, about 50-50. I mean, I'm interested in both, but I just kind of wanted to know. So the ones that raised their hands for assisted living, you're now on the spot. So I'd like you to answer his question. If you could please go to a microphone and maybe say, A, this is just brand new to you. You wanted to maybe learn some more, or you are interested in getting involved in this, but you are hesitant. So if anybody is so bold as to get up to the microphone and do that. Yeah, hey, there you go. I wish I had something I could throw you as a gift.
Thanks.
But I don't.
Okay. I'm Hans van Schaik, I'm from Holland. It's an interesting subject to talk about assisted living and immediately go to the, what I would call, without any prejudice, the extreme, which is somebody who's disabled and has no capabilities to communicate properly, or et cetera, or is very old. But the reality, obviously, what you mentioned, everybody gets older and nobody can go to a place where he's taken care of when he's not completely disabled, but maybe a little bit less, the movability is less, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's a much broader group that you basically have to deal with to make it interesting, because in existing projects in Holland, the investment on those type of subjects that you are referring to is relatively high and has to be managed by institutions that have to find budgets, et cetera, which is very complicated. While if you go to the line below, it's maybe easier to get a business case together and also then take care of the more complicated group as well.
You must have my notes. Because that's exactly what we discussed. You've had great success on the real needs side and on the physical disability side, and also government support probably to pay for that stuff. And it's all important, but personally, that is the area that we would love to focus on the most. Is maybe I can't hear so well, maybe I can't see so well, maybe I have slight mobility issues, maybe I have an autistic child, who knows what. I do think that is the masses. And so, Paul, would you like to get into the challenges of trying to crack? I think that's the nut that we need to crack, and that's the opportunity that affects the whole lot of us.
I see it from as a spectrum, and obviously, I suppose to a certain extent my opinion is coloured by the fact that I work with people at the very end of the other end of the spectrum. But you're absolutely right. I mean, people will become more physically challenged as they age. And I think the processes that we use to understand and then design outcomes, and I think a lot of the things that people tend to focus on are the technologies, but really what people want who are old or disabled or need a little bit of assistance are necessarily are outcomes rather than technologies. So I want to live independently, so what are the technologies I want to use to help me achieve that outcome? So you're right, there are design thinking processes that we need to start pushing out into the wider community to give people the competence and the confidence to deliver those solutions.
I'll get to you in a minute, Alan. Design thinking, does anybody know what design thinking is? All right, if you don't know what design thinking is, you need to learn about it. And design thinking is a particular way, it came out of Stanford School of Design, and it's a way of addressing problems, and it involves a lot of empathy, so you can start to understand your customer and your customer's needs so you can properly design to meet those needs. So design thinking is a skill you should all have in your pockets if you're not aware of it. Let's switch to sustainability for a bit, and then we're going to get back. So you said you got into sustainability because you had a great sense of probably wonderment and need to address an issue within society. So why don't you give us your angle of what sustainability is as far as this talk goes today, what you're doing and where you think this is going, and also from a business standpoint.
Okay,
that's a lot. So
there's quite a lot that I might come back to you for some pointers. So for me, I think we have the technology now, and some of that technology is nascent, a lot of it is. We're aiming for net zero buildings, and when we look at the way energy has historically been supplied, it's coming from a big place all the way over there, and it's getting squirted en masse, high volume, all the way over there, and we take it for granted. And when I was teaching science, this is how I became a renewables person. I was very excited about this topic, so I was teaching when I was teaching about renewables. And we have the technology now to use energy more frugally. I like to compare, there's a slurping behavior and a sipping behavior, and I think we need to learn how to sip energy. I'm particularly interested in microgrids. I have a microgrid that's in my bag. It's a battery for my phone and my phone. And I even have a little light I can plug into it. And I have a mentality now that I've learned through that of how to take a bit of energy when I need it, when I'm going to be going a long way and not near a charge point, and be able to survive. And that's a learned behavior. How am I going to get this resource energy to see me through? And I think that's the kind of behavior and the kind of thinking that we need to bring into people's homes. So I think energy independence is likely to become more of a talked about issue. We're seeing what's happening in Europe at the moment. And I think we need to get away from macro energy to micro energy. And in terms of sustainability for assistive technology, we're going to be using electrification and electronics. So we need to provide energy security to create the stability and the resilience of these systems that will give people independence in their homes. So they're part and parcel. They're part of the architecture of the design. They can't be separated.
Can I go ahead? Yes, please.
Sorry. Sort of alluding to this gentleman's initial sort of point, older and disabled people, but older people tend to be retired. And as a consequence, they may not necessarily be going out to work every day, or may not be able to go out of their property very easily. So therefore, they become really large consumers of energy. And as we all know within the European setting, energy has become it's at a premium as we speak. So being able to manage and reduce energy consumption, on that person's behalf, is an essential. However, from my perspective, using the backbone that we use to control that energy can also be used as well to provide some assisted living functionality. So if we're putting in smarts to keep energy at a minimum, why not see whether we can use those same smart energy infrastructure to create environments that people can control remotely. So if it's a person who's older and less able, maybe they don't want to be turning the lights on and off every 5 minutes or leaving them on. But if there's a smart infrastructure in there that can turn it off when they leave the room, it saves energy, but then also it means that they don't have to go back in, turn the lights off themselves. If there's somebody who's a little bit unsteady on their feet, they might trip and fall. So you're reducing risk, reducing energy consumption from using the same backbone. It seems to me very, very, almost like, well, why wouldn't you do that, rather than a case of why would you?
I really like to tie into these two subjects because up until this moment, I didn't really put these two together so succinctly until you guys just talked. You know, cost is one side of it. Energy's gotten very expensive, especially in the UK. In America, we have rolling blackouts where if you live in California, you know, you're told you're going to be without power for a couple hours because we're sending it over here. And now is the tie for A, being as efficient as you can be with the energy that you use, having storage solutions for critical operations for equipment that you might need to get up and down out of a chair. It might be breathing apparatus, who knows what it is. So it's taken smart home now. For me, smart home was a nice to have. You know, it's fun, you can control your lights and you can say, you know, hey Alexa this, or hey Google that, and you know, control your music. But now it becomes a critical part of your life as you age and change. So I totally see the side there, but I see a lot of complications with making this work. Would you guys like to get into the, we'll talk about the business side of it later, but just the, let's say I have a customer. I've identified a family that has needs. Everybody has slightly different issues. How, in your mind, would I go about implementing a system that would actually cater to their needs? Am I going to A, interview them and find out exactly what their needs are? Are there other trades that I may need to work with? Maybe occupational therapists or people that understand issues with sight or issues with hearing. How would you tackle this family and start to get a feel for how I'm going to prescribe something for them?
Can I have a bee in my bonnet over occupational therapists.
Oh, good. I pitched a nerve.
I work in the field of assistive technology, and for a number of years I've worked with some local universities in the Midlands who have schools of occupational therapy, who shall remain nameless. So every year, a team of students would be subject to my input on the basis of that I was an expert in assistive technology.
Yeah.
And to be fair, that was the only exposure many undergrad occupational therapists ever had, listening to me drone on for about an hour or two about assistive technology. The knowledge of the OT base is very, very intermittent. So therefore, many of the people who will be subject to those needs, to that assessment from an occupational therapist, will know what the outcomes are, but they'll not know what the technologies are to deliver those outcomes. I would pretty much bet that of the 60,000 people that came here today, there will not be an occupational therapist, even though many of the tools that are being demonstrated here would have an application in some of their clients' lives. There is a massive disconnect between clinical services and technical services. People don't know what they don't know, and I think the challenge we have is bringing together all those constituencies and having a meaningful discussion.
All right. That's a great tie. So let's talk about the role of, I'm going to just call him the integrator. The integrator is going to need to do what to pull this off? So already you said they're going to need to identify an intermediary like an occupational therapist, and they're going to need to be, and this is both from a sustainability side of things too, they're going to need to be that person. Who else are they going to need to work with to holistically pull this off?
Invariably, if it's a person that's in receipt of sort of support, if they have care, they may have an occupational therapist. They may have a social worker. For the work that I do within the medical legal space, they will have a case manager. And that case manager may be a clinical professional or a care professional. So they will understand the needs of this individual. But again, they need to be taught how the technology can be used to support their client. Yeah. So at the moment, and I was talking to Alan earlier, I've spent time and effort with people who've had smart home technologies installed. So it's a person with a mobility impairment. The smart home installation is second to none. It's absolutely fabulous. However, that final 9 yards has yet to be crossed. How that person is going to interact with that, with their smart home, because many of the individuals that I work with, they haven't got the manual dexterity to control a smart panel on the wall. So how do we use technologies to interface between their existing assistive technologies to control their immediate environment?
Yeah.
It's that gap that still exists. Now, this is a shameless plug. It might be that there are more clinical technologists required who can fill that gap, or alternatively, there's a training need for installers and integrators to understand the applications of their technology for older, disabled, or people in need.
Yeah, let's flip it to Alan. So, are you, and I'm just going to qualify that by: are we talking about the GUIs or the NUIs, the user interfaces? So, Alan, how would you address that concern?
Well,
is that also a roadblock for some of the things you're trying to do?
You say a robot?
Yeah, or a challenge.
Okay, so
we have show voice, so we're going to be clearing our throats.
The graphical user interface. Or indeed the user interface, the form it should take. That's a great example of how someone like me, an integrator, needs somebody who can brief them about what the end user's requirements are. So we've got lots of expert integrators in here, but you need a bit more of Paul's wisdom that he's acquired through interaction with clinical systems to even start to think about how that person's going to use the system that you're going to install. Most integrators have their go-to technology, and that go-to technology will have one or two interface options, and that has to be opened up and really analyzed clinically on a case-by-case basis. So as a practitioner myself and a designer, I have a procedure called the needs analysis, and I have a form and I go through it. Do you have a jacuzzi? Do you have an electric vehicle? What's your pattern of occupancy? And there has to be a new module within that, and as an integrator, I'm definitely looking for someone like Paul to mentor me on how to implement the technology and the kind of technology you and I are familiar with. In my experience, coming back to one of your earlier points, who are you working with? That landscape changes when you're working with people who are in the spectrum of having special needs. You might not be working with the client, you might be working with the client's carer. I've had an experience where I was working with a client's carer, and then another person who considered themselves to be the client's carer kind of waded in with very different opinions about how that person should be cared for. Now, that sounds like a minefield, and it is, and it was, and integrators need somebody to bring that wisdom in. We've all been in situations that I've learned from that's not going to happen again. But when you're dealing with people with those kind of needs, and by the way, if your client's got dementia, just think about that, what it's going to be like trying to go back and clarify points in the contract. It's going to be quite difficult, whole new skill set needed. So for me, I'd like to clone Paul and just have him in the back of the van for whenever I go to a job that has somebody with special needs.
Can I make a point about GUIs?
Anytime you want.
A number of years ago, I did some work with a care home provider, and their solution to all things was to provide the clients with iPads, because with iPads they could schedule their lunch, they could turn the heating up and down.
How old were these people?
Sorry?
How old were the people?
These people were, say, 75 up.
How'd that go?
So, well, it was an unmitigated disaster.
I knew you were going to say that.
What was really interesting was sort of the dementia aspect, was that people with dementia obviously have short-term memory issues, so they're told that this is an iPad and they can do these things. And invariably, it would be put down on the table in front of them. And the individuals, initiation, it was also impaired, so they wouldn't think to do something. So the iPad became effectively the part of the table. Yeah. So it didn't reach out and engage with this individual because it's an inert object. So I think one of the challenges for people with dementia is not necessarily the GUI being passive, is it being active, pushing out. with technology, most of us, we push technology in, or we push information into technology using these, yeah, or this. But with somebody who's impaired cognition means that they're not going to actively interact with technology, it needs to reach out to them to give them that opportunity. So, and if you can do that by tomorrow afternoon, that'd be really helpful.
You know, the one thing I'm getting from this conversation is this is really hard. There is nobody better suited.
Not technologically.
Yeah. But correct. But the integrator is the person best suited for it. But I do think the integrator is going to need to learn a lot more skills. They're going to need to definitely have empathy and design thinking. They're going to need to be able to work with other trades, like you talked about, the caregivers and the occupational therapists. You're going to have to craft a new network. And then the other thing I think is really interesting is, it's just hearing you gentlemen talk, each system is a bespoke system. No two are kind of the same. So it's almost going to be custom for each person you're trying to help, or are there generalities that you can do to try to help people that wouldn't be so bespoke?
I think for the lower level needs analysis.
Now, there is for sustainability,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. For
you.
In relation to that, there are tools that, to be fair, what one could do is extend that needs analysis tool that you've got, and start saying, you know, are there times and circumstances during which you find it difficult to reach the light switches, the curtains, the doors? If there's somebody at the front door, can you always answer? These are relatively straightforward issues. My area tends to get a little bit more complicated, and I use a thing called the International Classification on Functioning Disability in Health, which is
that
a world
rolls off the tongue.
Yep, a World Health Organization tool. So there are tools there. But obviously, I've had many, many years' experience of using that, and I wouldn't expect anybody to pick that up. But there already are tools there that we can extend and expand to make the generalized assistive spaces more easily to assess for.
How will you bring those into the realm and to the attention of integrators? Well, how do you think that should happen?
CEDIA.
Trade right over there.
Yeah, trade representative.
Yeah,
this is a knowledge and understanding issue. Absolutely,
like CEDIA.
Absolutely. I mean, the UK government at the moment has got a thing called the Longitude Prize on Dementia, and they're looking at using AI to help people with dementia live independently for longer. However, there is no practical mechanism for delivering those solutions as and when they come online.
Yeah.
This magic, you know, we will create this solution and we'll all be sort of amazed by it, and we probably will be. But then Alan and his community, they're not being engaged in that delivery mechanism. We develop products with them, love them or loathe them. Amazon have got a mechanism for delivering their technology and delivering their products. Whereas if we create these artificially intelligent agents that work on behalf of people with dementia, who's going to deliver it?
Yeah, that's a good segue. So we know it can be done. So cost, right? Money is going to be an impediment for a lot of this. Is one of the barriers currently right now assistance, government assistance or policies? I'm just trying to identify everything that will help us understand why we are where we are and what might need to change, so that this does reach more of a critical mass from a deployment standpoint for both sustainability and for assisted living.
Can I make a point? Yeah, absolutely. If you throw a stone here, you'll probably hit a screen. There are millions and millions of screens here. And working with older and disabled people, what I've found is that people, when they live at home and stay at home more readily, they will invest quite a large sum of money in their television because it's their window to the world. And
right.
Some of these televisions can be thousands and thousands of euro. So this is somebody who's making a choice to buy a piece of technology that they feel will enhance their lives. And within the United Kingdom, sorry to bring it back to the UK, but within the United Kingdom, we have a term called the Purple Pound. Now, the purple pound is very much like, we have the pink pound for the lesbian and gay community, and then we have the silver pound for the people who are over a certain age. Well, the purple pound is an economic the economic power of people with physical disabilities, and that runs into another NHS, £80 billion a year. And this is the spending power of people with a wide range of physical challenges. However, we're not tapping into that purple pound. The funding mechanisms pretty much are there. Older people who are retired will invest in technologies that they feel will have an immediate and meaningful impact for them. We're not telling them of these technologies. People are starting to, you know, I think a big champion for this particular cause is the Ring doorbell.
I was going to ask about, well, one of the terms is FANG, right? Facebook, yeah. Apple, and all that. So, yeah, that's raising awareness.
So people are now beginning to realize that they can see who's at the front door without having to get out of their chair. So if you've got an arthritic hip, so we're not talking about high-level disability, or you're somebody who's recovering from COVID, with long COVID, it's an effort to get to that front door. So you will invest in that technology to make sure that the person calling is somebody that you want to let in,
right,
or alternatively, not bother, let them leave their Amazon parcel on the doorstep. So we are there is a mechanism there in terms of funding, but it's about joining those particular dots.
Alan, how about it from the sustainability standpoint? Is this, what are your challenges in trying to deploy this to every house and make people understand that you know, managing your power and having critical loads and you know, and when something isn't so important, I don't need it, and you know, just that whole thing. What are your challenges with that?
Well, we work with sensors, and we have an incredible and ever-increasing range of sensors. The one sensor I've noticed that makes a difference to the people I talk to when it comes to energy management, we have a rollout of smart meters in the UK, and talk about what I've observed in the last year when price of fossil fuels just rocketed. There was an awful lot of smartphone home display units coming out of the cupboard, the back of the cupboard, new batteries being found to replace the ones that had started to corrode because it hadn't been looked at. And basically the occupation of a lot of people became going around the house and working out where that last 50 watts was and going on a hunt all around their house. So information and having some options about what they can do, and I think there are options now on a sort of macro level. You can choose to have a fossil fuel car or an electric car, that's the choice. You can choose to have an energy efficient kettle versus one that just really, really goes for it. And people need to be able to count the cost, and they need to be able to see alternatives. It's up to us as integrators to spell out to them some of the alternatives that they can look at, for example, how they wire their house, so that they can have more options. Maybe they can have different zones. Paul mentioned a Ring doorbell. A Ring doorbell is a fantastic device. I think it's, are they battery operated or they take
a
wire?
They are both.
Okay.
Yeah.
I want cables. I want a cable in there. I want a future ready cable, something that can deliver power and do data. Then if there's a problem with Ring down the line, you've got the option to swap out to another technology. We have to analyze how these markets are going to fragment or conglomerate. And those things are going to happen outside of the consumer's control, outside of our control. The likes of Amazon and Google, they're just going to keep pumping the stuff out. And it's a given whether or not they're going to nail it and do a good job for energy independence and independence for, should we say, special needs. We, as integrators and electronic designers, we can put cables in so they've got the choice. If they decide that the Amazon or the Google isn't doing the thing for them they need, there's infrastructure there so that they can exercise their choice. And that's another form of independence. Probably the best way to put independence, if you have a choice.
I would think another thing that you need to do as an integrator to try to sell this is to let people know you're going to save money because I'm going to manage your energy, and it's worth the money because I'm going to try to improve your life, your lifestyle through technology, so you can do more and may hopefully even be more active. So there is a reward that's worth the investment. And
absolutely,
you would need to have that as part of your message to convince someone to do it.
From a policy perspective, happy, healthy, well-balanced individuals are cheap. in comparison to unhealthy, mentally ill, you know, challenging individuals. You know, so if we can use technology to keep people, you know, as best we can, happy, healthy, and in their own homes, why wouldn't one do that from an individual and a sort of an institutional and governmental level?
Yeah.
That we are looking at sort of the notion that, you know, energy is a hot potato, because obviously it now costs. People recognize the fact that, you know, they need to save energy because it's hitting them in the pocket. The question I would ask is, why don't we feel the same level of urgency about our health and well-being?
I know, we always ignore that, right?
Yeah.
Even going to lounge concerts without hearing protection, you know, obviously that's a common example.
We're getting older, by dint of that, you know, we will find that there are aspects of our living that become less easy, more challenging, and yet I will invest in, you know, smart energy technologies, but not necessarily things that are going to make my life easier. Somehow there's a disconnect. Do we not like the idea of getting older and becoming less able, so therefore push it to the back? You know, because that's, you know, it's a false economy, really.
Yeah. It's a great question you raise. Speaking of questions, does anybody have any questions in the audience? If you do, please go to a microphone. This is such a broad topic. There's so many things that we can talk about with both of these areas. Does anybody have something they would like us to address that we didn't think of talking about up here?
Is anybody?
Nope. Okay. Well, we're going to end because we're just about at the end of our segment. But if you do have questions, you can catch us off stage. I want to thank you very much for talking about this subject. It's a massive opportunity, one that we don't quite have in our grasp yet, but we know it's imminent, and we're going to be doing it. So thanks for the expertise. I've also done podcasts with both of you, the CEDIA podcast, about, you know, energy and about assisted living, and we'll be doing more of that. So we'll continue to be talking about this as there's developments, and just to follow how we can maybe get more involved in this industry. So thank you very much for the talk today, and thank you all for giving us the time.
Thank you.
Bye.
Brilliant. Well done. Mm-hmm.